court is back in session. You may be seated.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, let me, for the purpose of ruling on the state's objection, I'm going to state the following. As soon as we get the defendant. All right, before we took a recess, the state offered an objection, a standing objection, to testimony by any witness of sexual abuse that did not directly correlate to the defendant. I considered the argument of both sides in this situation, and I would simply observe that in a sentencing hearing, as I have recited the case law earlier in a different context, that the sentencing hearings are different than the normal trial, and the normal rules of evidence do not apply in this. Therefore, it is appropriate to allow more testimony than might otherwise be allowed on the issue of relevance. At a trial, those rules will be relaxed somewhat for a sentencing hearing. It is my understanding that the defense intends to offer the proof of these witnesses who are alleged to be survivors of sexual abuse at the hands of the defendant's father for the purpose of bolstering and corroborating the allegation that he himself was abused in some fashion by his father. And for that reason, it is my opinion that, again, erring on the side of caution to make sure that there's not any problems in this case, I will allow that testimony. However, the state is clearly entitled to, on cross-examination of those witnesses, bring out whether or not there's any direct correlation to the defendant in this case. And then it will be for the jury to make the decision as to what relation or how relevant that evidence is, and whether or not what weight to give to that evidence in their consideration. But I think that I must allow it to come in under the purview of a sentencing hearing in a capital case. It's my understanding that the next two witnesses are going to be witnesses who are going to testify about personal sexual abuse that they suffered at the hands of Scott Wiggins. And for that reason, we are going to ask that the live stream of this part of the testimony cease and not be shown out of not respect for anything other than the privacy of an individual who is alleged to be a survivor of sexual assault. So for those reasons, we will stop the live stream on YouTube, and we will stop the live stream on the network. So as soon as we can accomplish those two things, protect their privacy about the nature of the charges or the nature of their testimony. So we are now going to begin live streaming again. Mr. Evans, who is your next witness?
Brenda Guinn.
Mr. Guinn, if you'll come up, please.
You would stand right here and face the clerk, raise your right hand this morning.
Do you solemnly swear or affirm the testimony given this day to be the truth, the whole truth, nothing but the truth, so help you God?
Good afternoon, Ms. Guinn.
Good afternoon.
If you would, please state your full name and spell your last for the benefit of the jury and the court reporter.
Mm-hmm. My name is Brenda Ann Guinn, G-U-I-N-N.
And where do you live, Ms. Guinn?
I live in Harriman, Tennessee.
All right. And how long have you lived there?
Oh, probably most of my life. Probably total 60 years.
Oh, wow.
So a long time.
And are you married?
Yes.
And do you and your husband own several investment properties?
We do.
Rental properties?
Mm-hmm. We do.
All right. And how long have you owned rental properties?
1989 forward.
Okay. And is one of those a trailer out on Rockbridge Road in Harriman?
It is.
All right. Mm-hmm. I'm going to pass you a photograph and see if you can identify this for me.
Yes, that's it.
Your Honor, I'd move that photograph in as the next numbered exhibit.
This would be 272.
And is that photograph, is that a photograph of the trailer on Rockbridge Road?
Yes.
At one point in time, did you actually rent that trailer to Miss Juanita and Scott Wiggins?
Yes.
And do you remember about when that was?
I'm thinking, I tried to find our files, but my husband's been sick and I've been real busy. But I'm thinking somewhere in mid-90s, maybe.
Okay.
I'm not real sure on that date, and I apologize on that.
And that's fine. That's fine. Do you remember about how long they rented the trailer from you?
I do not. I couldn't tell you exact or close to how long.
All right. You think it might have been a couple years?
Probably 2 years. A year and a half to two and a half. I'm just not real sure.
All right. And during the time that they were at the trailer, do you ever remember any occasions of you going by that trailer?
Yes, sir, I did. Not a whole lot, because Miss Wiggins would mostly come by our home and pay, or if I went there to get the rent is normally why I was there.
Okay. And you say Miss Wiggins would normally, you mean Juanita Wiggins, but she was the one that paid the rent?
Yes, she was the one I met that paid the rent.
Do you remember a particular occasion going by the trailer and seeing something that caught you by surprise about the condition of the trailer itself?
Yes, I do. I was there one day, and I went in, and she said, Juanita said the church had given them some canned foods, and it was thrown, all over the kitchen, living room area. Green beans, I remember specifically, but it was canned, homemade canned jars of food. Someone from the church, she said, gave them, and they were thrown over the living room and kitchen.
And you mean, like, when you say canned, you mean like ball jars, right?
Ball jars, yes,
yeah,
homemade.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay. And were they shattered? You said they were thrown?
Well, I didn't see shattered. I saw empty jars, and mostly I saw the food.
And how was the food? When you say you saw the food, what do you mean?
Well, it was just thrown out of the jars.
Oh, so it was all over the place.
Yes, it was.
Did Miss Juanita Wiggins tell you how that had happened?
Mm-hmm. She said her husband, opened them up and threw them out in the house.
And was there another occasion where you talked to Miss Wiggins about an incident that she said occurred with her husband Scott and her little boy Stephen Wiggins?
I remember one time she was upset, and she said that Scott, that was his name, Scott, was it? I just rarely seen him, Scott. Okay. He and the son were in the car, Stephen, and there's a little dip, like in the road there, that goes over, and she said that he had turned their lights off and got on the wrong side of the road and said if a car came over, it would hit him.
Okay. And And when you say them, when she was telling you this, was it her? Was it supposed to have been Scott and Stephen Wiggins, the little boy?
Yes.
Okay. And while she was there, were you aware of another incident that happened where the police got called out to the trailer?
I wasn't there, but she told me about it, several days after that. And it was, she had called the police, and between the mobile home and the house next door, there's a dip like there. And she said he was hid there in the, it was, you know, it wasn't the yard, but it was between the house. He was hid there. And when the police come, she didn't tell him where he was.
And she tell you why she didn't tell?
Well, she just said she was afraid that if he went and he might make bond and come back.
And did there come a time where Miss Juanita moved out of the trailer?
Yes, she did.
All right. And do you remember how you found that out?
Mm-hmm. She came by my house and told me that she and I guess the boy were going to have to leave right then, and couldn't even tell her mom.
Did she say why she had to leave so abruptly?
Well, she said she was having to hide from her husband.
Okay. And do you remember how she moved out of the house, or how her belongings were gotten out of the house, or the trailer rather?
My husband and my son gathered. We built storage buildings also, and they loaded up all they could get of her stuff in the storage building. And I didn't go. I almost went because I thought I might get to see her. But when they got to the exit that they had to meet, some other people had come. She couldn't even come to, you know, to. They got their stuff. The other folks got her stuff and took it up there wherever she was. I never knew where she went. I mean, I knew the area and the exit off the interstate, but I never saw her again.
And so when your husband and your son took her stuff up, she didn't even tell them where she was staying, is that right?
Well, she didn't come. Some other people came. She may have called one time after that and, you know, thanked for them bringing her stuff up there, but nobody's, you know, they didn't see her.
Yes, ma'am. I really appreciate you being here today. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. You're welcome.
Those are my questions.
Okay.
Mr. Grouch.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
About how old was the defendant when this happened, this last incident you described?
He was just a young boy. I'm thinking early, maybe 12, 14. I'm not real sure. I didn't see him a lot. You know, he was there, but like most kids, they were, you know, not right there when I was, you know, when I went in. But I'm thinking just a, you know, young, maybe, if I had to guess, 12.
Okay. And they moved, when I say they, the defendant and his mother, on further east. Is that correct?
Yes, they moved. My husband met them at the Newport exit.
In Newport. Mm-hmm. And moved away from Scott, his father.
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Redirect?
No, you're right.
Thank you, ma'am. You may step down and you are released from your subpoena. You may stay or you may go. You may call your next witness.
Our next witness is Dr. Sean Agharkar.
I swear from testimony given this case be the truth, the whole truth, nothing but the truth, self-doubt.
Yes, I do.
Good afternoon, Dr. Agharkar. Good
afternoon.
If you wouldn't mind, please state your full name and spell it for the benefit of the jury and the court reporter.
Sure. My full name is Bhushan, Bhushan. Last name is Agharkar, Agharkar. That's why I go by Sean.
So, Dr. Agharkar, what do you do for a living?
I'm a medical doctor. I'm a psychiatrist.
And how long have you been a psychiatrist?
I've been practicing since 2005, so 16 years now.
And if you wouldn't mind, would you tell the jury a little bit about your educational background?
Sure. I did my undergraduate at Case Western Reserve University in Cleveland, Ohio. Once I got my, well, actually I left there after 3 years. I then went to medical school in Syracuse, New York, which is where I'm from. I got my medical degree in 2000, and then I moved to Atlanta, and I did a four-year residency in adult psychiatry at Emory University. I was chief resident my last year at Emory. And then in 2004, I did a forensic psychiatry fellowship. So that's additional training after my residency in forensic psychiatry. And that was 2005, and I've been in private practice since that time.
What is forensic psychiatry?
Forensic psychiatry is a subspecialization of psychiatry. You can specialize in child psychiatry. You could do geriatric psychiatry. So there are different fields you can specialize in. So in addition to treatment of adults, I also chose that I chose to do forensics. And so forensic psychiatry is really any interaction between psychiatry and the law. So if there's a legal question for which a medical or psychiatric opinion could be helpful, so competency to stand trial, insanity defenses, malpractice cases, disability, so you're all familiar with those kinds of things. Somebody like me could give opinions about those to aid the trier fact and come to a conclusion that way.
And do you hold any particular certifications or licensures?
I'm licensed to practice medicine, of course, since 2001, I think it is. And I'm board certified in adult and forensic psychiatry. And every 10 years, you have to recertify. You've got to take the test again. And I did that for both, and I passed them both again. But that was 8 years ago now, so I think I'm due very soon again.
And have you been published in your area of expertise?
I've published a number of articles, yes, related to competency to stand trial issues, fetal alcohol spectrum disorder, schizophrenia, so a variety of topics.
And have you also acted as a lecturer on several topics in the area of psychiatry and forensic psychiatry?
Yes. Well, so I'm on the faculty at Emory as well as Morehouse School of Medicine. For a while, I was the assistant residency training director at Morehouse, and I continue to teach there. I teach forensic psychiatry. I teach just a basic kind of 101 course, like what's mental illness, what are medications, how do you use them. Right now, I teach an advanced psychopharmacology course, which means what are the drugs, how do we use them, what do they do. I've also lectured at a number of law schools. I've listed them on my CV, maybe 8 law schools. Where I lecture law students about issues related to psychiatry and the law.
I'm going to pass you a copy of your curriculum vitae.
Thanks.
Do you recognize that document?
Yes. Looks like there's 2 of them stapled together, but yes. This is my CV.
All right. Your Honor, I would ask that his CV may next numbered exhibit.
273.
And have you been qualified as an expert by the court before and testified?
Yes, I've consulted on cases nationally. I've probably done, 2020 was a bad year for everybody, but I'd probably say almost 1,500 evaluations in my career. I've testified in both state and federal court across the country.
Your Honor, at this time, I would proffer Dr. Agharkar as an expert in psychiatry and forensic psychiatry.
Any objection? He'll be qualified as an expert in psychiatry.
Thank you, Your Honor. Dr. Agharkar, at some point in time, were you contacted and asked to engage on behalf of Mr. Stephen Wiggins?
Yes, I was.
And as part of that, did you complete a report?
Yes.
All right, I want to hand you a copy of your report. And does that appear to be your report in relation to your opinions?
Yes,
regarding Stephen Wiggins?
Yes.
Okay. Your Honor, I'd ask that his report be made the next numbered exhibit.
Exhibit 274.
And did you also complete a PowerPoint presentation?
Yes, I put together some slides for today. And may I have my report to refer to?
Yes, I can. I'll hand you a copy.
Thank you. Yes, these are slides that I made for today.
Your Honor, I would ask that the PowerPoint slides be made the next numbered exhibit.
Exhibit 275.
Dr. Agharkar, do you have the clicker?
I do not have a clicker.
All right. We'll get to that in just a minute. We've got your PowerPoint pulled up over here, but before we kind of delve into the PowerPoint itself, I want to ask you, when you're contacted by someone like myself and asked to perform services in a case like this, what are your first steps? What do you do?
Well, I have a conversation with, in this case, it was you. Actually, today's the first day I've ever met you. I've never met you before. But you called me, if I remember right. And the first thing I do is just get some basics about the case. You know, what are you thinking about, or what is it you want me to evaluate for? To make sure I'm even the right person to do it, because I get calls sometimes to do IQ testing, for example. Psychologists do that. I'm not a psychologist. I don't do IQ testing. So I had a discussion with you just about what do we know about the history, what sorts of problems are we seeing, those kinds of things, just to get a broad sense of it. And then I said, send me relevant records. I'd like to see medical records. I'd like to see, you know, anything that can help orient me to the case. And then once I got some records, I conducted an interview.
All right. And when you say you conducted an interview, did you travel from Atlanta here to Middle Tennessee and actually meet face to face with Mr. Wiggins?
That's correct.
I'm going to start working through your slides. There was were there particular referral questions that you were asked to answer and investigate as part of your evaluation?
Yes. So I was asked two referral questions. The first is, does Mr. Wiggins display any symptoms of psychiatric or cognitive impairment? And if so, what is the likely origin of those symptoms? And the second is, did Mr. Wiggins experience chronic psychological trauma as a child and adolescent? And if so, what, if any, lasting effects did those experiences have on his development and function?
So, what do you do when you get those two questions? Let's take the jury from your perspective. What do you do to try to get those questions answered?
So primarily, it revolves around psychiatric interviewing, as well as review of collateral sources. And so in this case, I spent about a total of 4 hours with him on two occasions, you can see in April and July of this year. And the reason why subsequent interviews are very helpful, or doing more than one interview is helpful, is because particularly when we're talking about trauma or people who have been traumatized, that first session or interview, you don't necessarily get a lot of information, or certainly not all the information, because there's sort of a feeling out that goes on. Especially for men who have been traumatized, they don't often want to talk about what's occurred. And so they're not very necessarily open and forthright and forthcoming. I think he tried to be, but I just know from the second interview, I got a lot more information about what happened to him growing up. He really glossed over it, didn't really want to talk about it in the first visit. And so I learned a lot more. Plus, I get to see if his behaviors are consistent. How does he act? How does he approach me? Is what he's telling me what I know to be true of mental illness or people with brain damage or people who suffer with trauma? And so that's why I like to do one more than one interview spaced out in time if I'm able to do that. And so that's what I did in this case. I spent, like I say, about 4 hours or so. And then I reviewed quite a number of materials. I reviewed other experts' reports, his interview with police, as well as video footage. I looked at medical records and mental health records of both himself as well as family members. So there's really thousands and thousands of pages, I think, of material that I looked at in addition to conducting the interview.
And what type of, once you review all that, what were your impressions?
This is a little hard to quantify because it takes some experience in terms of doing it, but I walked away from the first visit believing he was brain damaged. I mean, this is what occurred to me very clearly through our interactions. I don't know how to quantify that other than to say I do a lot of these kinds of evaluations. And while psychiatry and neurology do overlap to some degree, there are certain things that just a feel you get. I just knew something was not right with this man's brain once I finished that first interview. And then subsequent testing and imaging, et cetera, was provided to me. And sure enough, that confirmed what I was suspecting. But Obviously, you know, in the history gathering, and history is very important in the medical field. Your doctor spends a lot of time going over your history because that will often tell us what kinds of problems can develop, what's likely to occur and happen in your life. So I was aware through talking to him about a very difficult upbringing, number of head injuries and concussions, abuse by the father, and, you know, kind of pervasive in the environment. I learned about you know, just kind of generally speaking, how he was growing up, but particularly then as well about some of the difficulties he had in weighing and deliberating and being able to, with his judgment with me, and some of these kinds of, we heard about impulsivity from Dr. Watson. I conducted a number of neurologic screenings as part of my first examination. These are relatively simple types of questions. These are questions anybody can answer. They're very simple things like, name all the letters of the alphabet you can think of that rhyme with the word key, right? Fairly straightforward, but it requires you to, it's a verbal fluency task. It requires you to be able to call up the letters of the alphabet and then place it together with rhyming. Well, he answered Y, E, and K. Now, K, of course, is incorrect, but as is Y, but he's spelling key, right? He fixates on the word I told him as opposed to the letters. That's an example of a task. I might ask about similarities between common objects. I would have him do things like the animal naming test. That's a very common screening test for dementia. It's very simple. Name all the animals you can think of, and I give him a minute. I don't tell him how long. I'm looking at my watch. You should be able to, you guys can do this in your head, you should be able to come up with 18. It's not that hard, in about a minute's time. And I think he came up with 12 or 11, and he repeated one more than once. That's a sign. That's a red flag. It's a problem. So, you know, these are, I can certainly go through all of them, but the point is that based on some of these screenings, he did okay on some, he did poorly on others. I walked away thinking this guy probably has problems in his frontal and temporal lobes. If I had seen nothing else, that's what I would have said, and that's actually indeed what turns out to be the case from the imaging and the neuropsychological testing. So that's what I walked away from the first visit, and then I told you guys that, and I got more information back. I said, yes, this certainly is consistent with what I would have expected. I certainly learned about a seizure disorder. That's a big problem. Electrical activity that's uncontrolled in the brain is bad for you. The more seizures you have in your lifetime, the worse it is. It's like your brain being on fire. Okay. So we know that people in the long term have poorer cognitive functioning as well as it relates to uncontrolled or continued seizure activity. So again, these are all things that point to me saying there's something going on with this guy's brain. There's some problem. I certainly never expected to see a hole in his head. He told me that. I didn't believe him. I thought he was sort of being hyperbolic in his statements. But there really is a hole in his head. And I will just tell you, I've looked at thousands of scans in my career. I'm hard-pressed to think of a scan I've seen like this. The only time I've seen this kind of thing before is if someone had a tumor taken out or some kind of major head injury like that. But other than that, or again, if you're born this way, then you can have that. But I mean, that's really quite remarkable. I'm hard pressed to think of the last time I've seen it, in fact, a hole like that in his head. So that has serious implications for behavior, as well as his ability to plan and to think appropriately. So in the second interview, I focused more on trauma, because that was clearly an area that he didn't really want to talk about with me, and I knew that was something that was significant with him. And I'll tell you, his affect was very different. Affect is the way he looks, okay? The way that somebody's talking. Are they smiling when they talk? Are they tearful, et cetera? He was much more, and I get this a lot from guys, but they want to show me how tough they are. They want to be macho. They want to kind of be, you know, big, right? And so I have to kind of work through that a little bit with them to some degree. The second one was much different. He was much calmer. There was much less of that going on. It still wasn't easy for him to talk about, and there were times he kept trying to shift the topic away from it, and I kept bringing it back, and he was uncomfortable. I could see that. These are very consistent with signs of trauma, with people who are trying to avoid thinking and feeling and thinking about these things that happened to them. Okay? And so we spent almost 2 hours really just talking about his childhood and the abuse he suffered and head injuries, etc. And so... it was really clear that trauma played a very large role in his life as well, which is a compounding factor, meaning it's one more bad thing that's happened on top of everything else, and it's pervasive. It's happened since he was little. So I thought that was a very important thing to discuss.
So, Dr. Agharkar, when you say it compounding. What is that? What does that mean?
So he starts out with this hole in his brain. What does exposure to trauma do to his already damaged brain?
It makes it worse. So I have a slide at the end about synergism, but the idea is that 1 + 1 = 3. It's not just 2. Okay, so it's bad enough to have one of these things, but you have being born with a brain like this. You have childhood trauma. You have head injuries. You have seizures. You have substance abuse. I mean, it gets each one stacks and stacks and stacks. It's much worse than like I say, one alone would be a problem. You got 5 at least. It makes it much, much worse. The brain is adaptive, but if it's damaged, it does not do a good job. It is impaired in its ability to adapt. And so it just makes it that much harder to overcome life's hurdles.
And someone with that brain, how does stress play into that?
A lot of the testing you've been hearing about, images, etc., that's like as good as he would be, okay? What I always talk about is that's when things are calmer, he's in a more sterile, quote-unquote, environment. So when you talk about stress makes it harder to think more rationally. If you all who have been through stress, decision-making gets difficult. I mean, you've got to slow down, you've got to calm yourself, you've got to think through it, right? That's easier said than done, and I think we all know people who have a very hard time with that sometimes, okay? People with brain impairment, particularly in the frontal lobes, will have a much harder time with this. So under stress, they are much more likely, it increases the risk of bad outcomes, of bad decisions being made. I like to think of it as like a card game, okay? You've got a certain stack of cards in your deck, okay? And you're faced with a life problem, you play a card. All right, well, that didn't work. Okay, what else? Okay, go to my next card in my deck. All right, play that card. That didn't get me out of the situation either. Okay, so, and you go on like that to try to figure it out. Well, someone with brain impairment has like 3 cards in the deck. They have less cards than the rest of us do. And so while we can continue to try to work our way out of the situation, that person with brain damage, brain impairment, cognitive problems has less cards to play. They run out of options sooner, as far as they're concerned. Okay. And so that's really why brain development, being born like this with this kind of brain, throwing trauma on top of that, et cetera, it disrupts the neural connections. We know that childhood trauma, particularly because the brain is developing, I think you heard Dr. Newberg and Dr. Bigler talking about this, the brain develops into our mid-20s. We know that now, at least. And neural connections are being formed. Well, when you're under stress or under a great deal of trauma, there's a hormonal cascade that's released in the body. Connections between different parts of the brain get disrupted. And so, as an example, the most common one typically is limbic hyperactivity. Or, in other words, the emotional parts of our brain tend to be hyperactive. We tend to think of things as a threat when they're not necessarily a threat. And the system revs much higher than the rest of us. Well, with Mr. Wiggins, not only is that the case, but then his frontal lobes are impaired. And when you have impaired frontal lobes, you've heard about them being talked about as brakes. That's our inhibitory control. That's the part of our brain that says, don't do that, you will get in trouble. Don't do that, this is not worth it. That's the part of our brain that says that. If that's offline or if that doesn't work very well, it's like a speeding car with faulty brakes. It's not going to stop the way it's supposed to stop. And again, like I say, the risk is higher that something bad is going to happen. I'm not saying it happens in all cases, but the chances go up when you have these types of impairments.
So how does that affect how someone with those brain impairments reacts to stress?
Well, as I say, it increases the chances that something bad is going to happen.
Well, does it affect how they perceive threats?
Yes, it can. It can in the sense that, again, with people who have been traumatized, essentially what happens is once you have been traumatized or under a great deal of stress, war veterans, rape victims, etc., the threat gets generalized to situations in which it's not necessarily appropriate. Okay, so a car backfiring to an Iraqi war vet means under attack. Okay, and they will immediately start acting like they're in the war zone again, as an example. I've treated patients who have been raped, cannot go in dark alleys. If that was somehow related to a rape, they stay away from that, always in brightly lit streets, always with somebody else, can never. It generalizes to every street and every dark place, even though it's not necessarily anything that would be dangerous. So our fear center, so to speak, our amygdala, as well as the brain region that we've been talking about, is hyperactive. It charges us up. It's what we call hypervigilance. It means it puts us on edge. It makes us think there's always going to be a threat when there isn't. We see this, like I say, I see a lot of guys, soldiers that have come back. They won't sit where I'm sitting. There's a door behind me. I can't see that door. I'm not doing that. I've got to be in a corner. I've got to be somewhere where I can see the exits and I can see who's coming, who's going. Okay? And people who've been traumatized, been shot at, they'll often have that kind of response. And that's what you're seeing.
And is there anything significant about how people cope with that stress?
Yes. I mean, of course, stress, of course, is normal in life, right? We all deal with stress. But the problem becomes when the stress is never-ending. It's relentless. It's excessive. And particularly, you know, it's one thing to deal with stress as a 40-year-old man. It's totally different if you're a 4-year-old, right? One person has much more control of their environment, has hopefully a more developed brain and can think their way through those things. A 4-year-old cannot do that and is reliant upon caregivers and authority figures. Those are the people who are supposed to help them. Well, what we're hearing here is the authority figures, in fact, did not model good coping mechanisms, right? Drugs are rampant, violence is rampant, abuse is rampant. This is not a situation in which a child can really get the help that he needs.
What we're talking about specifically with Mr. Wiggins?
That's correct, right? And so there's these different kinds of reactions to stress. I'm going to talk about coping, I think, on the next slide, so we'll just get to that. But you guys have all heard about the fight or flight reaction, flight or flight. That's what we hear about with stress. It's actually fight, flight, or freeze. People freeze also in those situations. But it can be more complicated than that. People can also have what we call this tend and befriend reaction. We particularly see this in women who have been traumatized. Typically what that means is they take care of they look for support in their social networks, or they're trying to get support in their in the family system or social system in order to keep themselves safe. In other words, if everyone else is calm and if everyone else is taken care of, I'm not gonna get beat. That's kind of the idea. The other is fight and drink. This is not a good way of dealing with things. What I mean by this is drinking alcohol, using drugs, tend to be more irritable, getting into bar fights, tending to fight more. Men are more guilty of this. Men don't talk about their problems. They don't seek help. They often drink. Men are stupid like that. And so that's a more common reaction that you'll see men do. These are not great ways to cope. Okay, and what I was talking here about, this is about an exaggerated perception of threat when one does not exist, and people tend to overreact. People who have been traumatized tend to overreact in response to the perceived danger, and then once they get going, as I say, particularly if you've got brain impairment, it's very difficult to put the brakes on once it's started. Okay? This is a very common thing we see in people with trauma. And so we try to cope. We try to adjust behaviors and feelings and thoughts to try to calm ourselves down. And there's lots of different ways to reduce stress, but the issue is what works, what doesn't work. And so people just do whatever they can. On the left side, you see the adaptive types of coping mechanisms, the good things. So that might be, expressing feelings, using social help, getting exercise, resting, meditating, those sorts of things. The maladaptive things that people do are to get drunk, or use drugs, withdraw socially, deny their feelings, escape either by running away or suicide. They develop more physical kind of complaints and aggressive type behaviors. So those are, I see a lot of people do the ones on the right, particularly involved in the criminal justice system. But kids do whatever they can do to survive. And so they learn what's been modeled for them and they do what's also easy to get in the environment that they're in. So I often get asked, well, why did they use drugs and alcohol? And I say, well, because, first of all, nobody really wants to see a shrink, first of all. There's the stigma associated with mental health treatment. People don't always have money for seeing a doctor. They may not have people, resources that they can, who will take them to a doctor. So what's the easiest thing to do? Smoke weed, drink alcohol. That stuff is easy. That stuff's there, and it works, right? I mean, it works. Otherwise, people wouldn't do it. It works in the sense of it calms your symptoms down. It brings you to a lower level. It soothes you. I mean, it just makes you forget. It helps you sleep. right? These are the things that people will notice that it does, but they, of course, become their own problem. Here with Mr. Wiggins, what we'll be hearing about is a lot of the stuff on the right. I think he had a lot of maladaptive coping mechanisms because, again, you have a brain-damaged, traumatized kid. What else is he going to do? Oftentimes I get asked, well, look, I had a tough childhood and I didn't do these bad things. I didn't end up in a bad place. Sure, everybody, lots and lots of people have bad childhoods. And there's a number of reasons as to why certain people have better outcomes than other people. We're still learning a lot about this. But one of the things that we look at are risk factors versus protective factors. So one of the things we see here is well, what, you know, okay, so you went through a tough childhood. What supports did you have? What were there some things that could have done to help you in this time? And what we see here are the people who tended to have better outcomes after really bad traumas or bad childhoods are having things like a strong extended family, having actual, you know, practical assistance, so that maybe, you know, rides, money, etc., consistent emotional support, you know, a personal family history, a parental history with at least one special figure, like a really beloved aunt or uncle or grandmother, somebody who took care of them and could not get them away from this whole situation and lead them out of it. So there's a whole bunch of things there. And as we're hearing from Mr. Wiggins' social history, that's not what his social history was like. That was not what his family history entailed. And so ultimately what happens is people learn how to cope. And the problem with time is that those things become their own problems. They become maladaptive ways of dealing with people and dealing with life. And as I say, someone who's already brain damaged has less resources available for them to figure out, okay, maybe there's a better way to do this here. They're not really going to be able to do that. They don't have the guidance for it. They can't self-generate it. That's what becomes very difficult when you have a brain that is impaired. Talked about this. There's different kinds of stressors or different kinds of traumas. Everyone's familiar, of course, with the war veteran type trauma, see my buddy killed in front of me, and ever from that one incident I have a number of problems like nightmares and these kinds of issues. But it's also important, and we are recognizing more and more, the importance of looking at chronic stressors. These are things that happen now sort of over time. They're not necessarily one bad incident, so if you ask the person, what's the worst thing? It's kind of hard to pick the worst thing because there's a lot of bad stuff, okay? So these bad things kind of happen over time. The issue is that it becomes prolonged and it erodes resilience. It keeps, because you can only fight the waves for so long before the waves overwhelm you, right? You can try and try and try, but eventually, without supports, it becomes overwhelming. So as I say, when people ask me about, you know, if I had these bad things happen and I didn't turn out that way, well, what's the difference? Well, I mean, there's individual variances, right? I mean, your age when something happened to you, how smart you are, what's in your family history. We know that mental illnesses are passed along just like medical illnesses, just like high blood pressure and diabetes, so is bipolar disorder and depression. So those things fall in families. You have genetic loading, which he had, towards proclivity towards having mental health problems. How bad the severity of the stressor is, in what context did it happen? What kind of support did a person have? I've treated rape victims who were roofied, so they actually have no memory of the rape. They knew they woke up somewhere, and they didn't really remember how they got there. But was what the most traumatizing thing was being blamed for it later by friends and saying, well, you wanted it. What are you complaining about? And being turned on by friends. And then all of a sudden, the social context of, but you know, who my friends are and why don't people believe me and this really happened, that becomes a trauma. And that compounds the trauma of the rape, even though there's no memory for the rape. So all those factors are involved in why people continue to have bad outcomes from significant traumas.
So just to follow up on a few things from that slide, one, what do you mean by biological factors?
So there, I mean, do you have a functioning brain? Does your brain function properly? Do you have other medical problems? Do you have other conditions that might impact your ability to cope with stress and cope with it well? Okay. And I do want to point this out too, because some of the questions that have come up around brain damage have been, well, he can walk and talk. He can hold a job. You can do those things and still be intellectually disabled. No one's saying that about him. But my point is, you can be intellectually disabled and do those things. You can have brain damage and do those things. It's not a zero-sum game. It's not all or nothing, okay? So you can still have damage to the brain and still look normal. You know, you can act and talk in a normal fashion. But it's, again, when we test for these things, when we look at how you're actually living your life, the kinds of decisions you make, that's where we start seeing impairments, okay? But I just want to bring that out as well.
One other question. You've used the example a couple of times about a war veteran. What would be the difference between that type of stress, that type of event, with someone who's grown, taking in that stress or being faced with that stress, and a child who's being abused, and the difference in how that would affect their brain?
It obviously depends on the stress that we're talking about. But children are far more vulnerable because their brains are still developing. And so, as I mentioned, it's not that their brain isn't fully formed, although his is not fully formed. It's the connections in the various areas. That's what gets disrupted. And the chemical cascade that occurs that, as I said, you know, make you hyper alert, make you think that there's all kinds of problems. Children who have been traumatized will typically act out behaviorally. They'll get into fights, they'll steal, they'll run away, they'll do all these other kinds of things because that's they can't have the verbal skills. They don't have the verbal skills yet to tell you really what's bothering them. They'll have a lot of nightmares, a lot of fear, a lot of bedwetting, you know, things of that nature. But children, childhood trauma falls into really this more chronic trauma kind of pattern because, again, as I say, the way we see this are in torture victims, sexual abuse victims, people repetitive physical abuse. So it's not one incident. It's this cumulative effect of many incidences that occurs. You know, the saying in our field is, you know, asking, you know, somebody about trauma when they've grown up this way, like what's trauma for you, is like asking a fish what water is. Okay? This is what they marinate in. This is what they live in. This is just normal life, but it's not normal life. It's just, this is what they think it is. And so their understandings of relationships are disrupted. Their understandings of authority figures are disrupted. You heard from one of the witnesses about a younger female cousin basically coming on to him and saying, I don't understand. What, you don't like this? My, you know, this other person does. That's what I mean. You know, the ideas of what normal relationships are supposed to be like, what love is supposed to be expressed as, and what that means, this all gets turned up on its head when somebody lives in this type of chronically traumatizing environment.
Based on your review of the records and the social history related to Mr. Wiggins, was he exposed to this type of chronic trauma from his childhood?
Yes, absolutely. And so they often get this misdiagnosis of ADHD. He was diagnosed with ADHD, for example. I'm less clear that that's really true as much as it is. I look at it as this is trauma behavior and it's brain damage. And because nobody checked his brain when he was young, unfortunately. Conduct disorder, oppositional defiance disorder, or substance abuse. You know, they just look at those things as saying bad behavior, bad kid. Okay, as opposed to thinking, well, what's really going on at home here, or what does this kid go home to when he's not in my office? Okay. As I say, it often is poorly recognized because we just tend to look at behaviors, and the children don't verbalize. They can't tell us what's really bothering them. Anyone who's had children and you've had to send your kids to school for the first time, what do they complain of? Tummy aches, right? Now, they don't all of a sudden have stomach aches, but they can't tell you that, hey, I'm really scared to leave the house for the first time and go to school and be away from you. But that's what children do. This is often why, because there's numerous records in this case. Sometimes he's talked about things that have happened to him. Oftentimes he has not. That is not uncommon at all. That's, in fact, very common for trauma survivors and people who have been abused not to talk about it. They don't want to relive it. They'd rather forget about it. And they certainly aren't going to just talk to a stranger about it. It takes time. In his case, he told me, you know, his father or mother told him, do not talk about it. Do not tell them what goes on at home. Because they don't want to get in trouble, obviously. They don't want children's services coming out, you know, and everything else. So there can be a number of reasons why it could be hard to get this information. He certainly minimized, and he more in the first than the second, but he certainly minimized, kind of said it wasn't that bad. Dad was a dick, you know, just kind of very broad global statements. He's, you know, it's far worse than that. We've been hearing the trauma is far worse than what we're talking about here. As I mentioned, avoidance symptoms because you don't want to talk about it. If there's been a history of just not being believed, or if you've been threatened, if you tell the truth, if you tell somebody what happens, I'll beat you more. If you don't trust people, of course, as I say, there's shame, and then there can also be dissociation or a lack of memory. You know, sometimes for traumatic incidences, we just don't have a memory for them. That's a way of the brain protecting itself, in a sense. You know, we don't want to think about it or deal with it because we have to survive. We have to go on with our lives and keep going. So we can't keep thinking about these things if we want to be able to do that. You have a question there?
So on the difficulties in history taking, you said that Mr. Wiggins minimized and didn't, you know, when you say minimize, you said that's common, right?
Correct.
So did Mr. Wiggins actually indicate abuse in the first meeting or not at all?
He indicated it, things like, you know, I got hit in the head by a 2x4 when I was young.
By whom?
By his father.
Okay.
You know, he has these sort of pat, and I've learned now, having spent some time with him, that he has these sort of pat stories that are kind of like, whoa, you know? And they get kind of people to kind of back off. And for him, he's like, all right, so I told you about it. And, you know, but he doesn't tell you more details about what else dad was like and what everything else. That stuff you really have to probe more and ask more details. And like I say, I noticed him kept trying to get away from that topic as whatever he could. And I had to keep bringing him back. It made him very uncomfortable. And I could see that. I could see by the end of our second interview, he was very happy I was leaving. That's how most people feel about me. So.
But is that typical with victims of severe abuse?
Yes, it is. It's something I've seen quite a bit.
In both physical abuse and sexual abuse?
Yeah, I mean, again, like I say, how can you go about your day if you have to keep thinking about the bad things that happened to you?
Now, in your next slide after this one, you talk a little bit about losses in childhood. Why is that important?
Because a child is not a functioning adult. So if you can remember back to your childhood, you rely upon your parents or important caregivers in your life, whoever was there to take care of you. That's who you need. You need that person for food and shelter and clothing and love and support and everything, right? So a child is very vulnerable to changes in the environment, to disruptions in relationships, to stressors, because it's out of their control. They can't do anything about it, right? And so they really become victimized by it. So these are just examples of things that in childhood that can be traumatic, and they're examples of losses. Obviously, death of a loved one. Particularly, there have been some studies done, really, really good studies looking at this. Early parental loss, particularly of the mother, but it has a very high correlation with later life depression, as well as anxiety and PTSD. But it's in that, I think it's actually before your age of 2, if you've lost a parent, your risk goes up tremendously for development of depression later. So it tells us really something about that. Those early attachments are very important. So death of important family members is certainly a loss. Having to change homes and schools, again, the shifting environment, a change in the parental relationship, like a divorce, either having medical illnesses yourself, disability, or disability in your social network are ways that people can be lost, as well as, again, anything having to do with a parent. So the father absence, being abandoned by parents, or parental absence due to military service, incarceration, etc. These are all examples in which a child can be traumatized that are not abuse, but these are changes in the environment.
Yeah. You have a situation where there's 2 children in a home, both subject to the same type of chronic abuse, where they react differently to the stressors.
Well, they can react. Oh, yeah, sure, of course. I mean, they can react different to the stressors in real time, and then they may have very different outcomes later on. But typically, when you look at people like this, the reasons are there can be a number of them. One, for example, I've done cases where the girl was taken out of the house. She was protected by an aunt, I think it was, in that particular case, taken away, put into a private school. That family had much better, more money, etc. She had a great outcome. She did very well in her life. Her brother did not, you know, because the brother had to stay. The brother did not get away from the house hold in which these things were happening. Again, intact brain functioning. If one person has an appropriately functioning brain, the other has brain damage, that's going to lead to better outcomes if you've got a better brain, okay? So there can be a whole bunch of reasons. And as well, in terms of even your genetic loading is different. You know, there can be diabetes, for example, runs in families. And, you know, you can have a set of siblings, one of whom the sibling is insulin dependent, diabetes, and the other just has to watch his diet, you know? And you can have a spectrum there, and it just hits people harder for just bad luck, unfortunately, just whatever your genes came out to be. So there can be reasons why two siblings raised in the same family can have very different outcomes. So it's complicated. So we'll get to Mr. Wiggins. A lot of this you've already heard, but these are the kinds of things that I learned from the record as well as my interview with him. Obviously, that his father was very physically and verbally abusive. He tried to kill his mother as well as himself. His last memory of him was the father chasing the mother and him through the woods in the dark with a shotgun, and that he planned to kill them, and they were able to get away and call for help. He also recalls a time which his father attempted to set their trailer on fire, but they heard him and they woke up and he ran off. He didn't do it. You heard some about the psychological abuse, just in terms of the manipulation. But he told me a story about how his father wanted information out of him, so he took him in a car. They drove up a hill and stopped at the top of the hill in the dark and turned the lights off. And this was a path in which coal trucks that would travel. This is the road in which coal trucks would travel. And they sat there, and he said, a truck is going to come and kill us if you don't tell me what I want to know. So there's that kind of abuse that occurred. He saw his mother bloodied by his father in front of him. The father was sexually abusive, as we've heard. He has symptoms that I'm seeing here about that are consistent with schizophrenia, but I didn't see a diagnosis of that, so I'm not sure. But there may be a serious, and probably is a serious, untreated and undiagnosed major mental illness with him, as well as substance abuse. Mr. Wiggins told me how his father would beat him until he would pee on himself. That made his father laugh. Then it would stop, the beating. But he would kind of wait until that happened, until it got that far. He was left with bruises and welts. He would have to stay out of school for days so that these things would not be detected by teachers and he wouldn't get in trouble, or the parents wouldn't. Mr. Wiggins told me how his father made him watch porn with him when he was young, 8, 11, that sort of age. And that obviously disturbed him a lot. He would try to leave, or just if he was forced to be there, he would just try not to look. And essentially, he's living in this chaotic, unpredictable home environment that's constantly threatening. So these are the kinds of things that we're hearing about in his childhood and how that would affect him. Well, he continues to this day to have nightmares about beatings that occurred in childhood. He has flashbacks, which are intense memories that occur while in the waking state that bring you back to that time, almost playing like a videotape that you can't stop. I'm sure you've seen this in movies a lot, but that's kind of what we talk about with flashbacks. This hyperarousal or hypervigilance, as we talk about, he's always on edge, he says. He's always assuming someone's going to try to hurt him. He has an increased startle. He's just kind of always up. Avoids thinking about this, and as well as trying to numb himself. He notices that his emotions, tries to keep him, just tries not to feel things wherever possible. He did start tearing up with me in the second interview when we were talking about this topic. And then, of course, substance abuse as well. Substance abuse is very common. He started smoking marijuana, apparently, when he was quite young. He said he smoked marijuana with his mother, that was modeled for him. But it was easy for him to get. And again, like I say, it works. It calms you down. It calms your irritability. He said it makes him forget things and helps him fall asleep. So, that he liked that. These are very common types of symptoms that you see in people who have been traumatized. Lastly, I talked with him about the ACEs questionnaire. And the ACE stands for Adverse Childhood Experiences. This is a major study that's been done by the CDC in conjunction with Kaiser Permanente. They have a huge group of folks that they studied. So it's an epidemiological study in which they administered this questionnaire. It queries 10 areas, and it asks basically these types of questions. So you can see what they're about: physical abuse, verbal, sexual abuse, food insecurity and general hygiene issues in terms of economic status, whether there's a family history of alcohol and drug use, how supportive is your family, parental separation, divorce. These are actually the same kinds of things I was just talking to you about with regards to childhood trauma. So this is a major study that they did, and they're looking at these effects. These questions are asked before you were 18 did these things happen? Okay? And it's just a yes or no. This happened in your life. Well, the CDC found that if you have four of these out of these 10, it's associated with much poorer outcomes later in life, a much higher incidence of medical problems, psychiatric problems, incarceration, I mean, just all kinds of problems that occurs. Mr. Wiggins had 9 of the 10. The one he denied was sexual abuse. But as we heard in the social history, and he denied it again to me as well, but apparently there's some indication that he may have been sexually abused. That's what he told a friend when he was around 8 years old, that his father had done that. And I would say a father who is making his son watch porn at the age of 8 or 9 or 10 and who's been sexually abusing other people, I don't think that's far-fetched to think he might have been sexually abusing Mr. Wiggins, but he wouldn't talk to me about that, so I don't know for sure. He'd have 10 out of 10 if that were the case, but by my analysis, he had 9. So it's very significantly poorer outcomes associated with that, obviously. So what do we make of all this? Well, as I was saying, these have synergistic effects. So again, having one of these things would be bad enough. But when you have multiple things, it just gets worse and worse. Like I said, 1 + 1 = 3 when we're talking about the brain, and we're talking about behavior. And so we have this childhood trauma that we've been talking about. He has a history of head injuries and concussions. So the brain is being jostled around. Whatever the damage was already is getting compounded and getting worse. Okay? It has less reserve. That's another way of thinking about it as well. That, you know, a brain that's healthy, that has a head injury or concussion, as Dr. Watson was saying, can recover relatively quickly and be generally okay from getting your head bumped, playing football or maybe in a car accident, that kind of thing. But if your brain is already damaged, you have less reserve. You don't have as much to be able to pull from to get better, okay? And the more that happens, the less reserve you have, the worse you get, okay? Substance abuse, as I mentioned, there's methamphetamine in his adult years, but there's mostly marijuana in his life. That doesn't help. That's not good for you. And that will not affect that will not help your decision-making or your brain functioning. And then his brain damage. He has impairments in his frontal and temporal lobes. And the reason why we're very confident in this is because we see it. We see it in the MRI. We see it in the PET scan. We see it in the neuropsych testing. My examination, my screenings, that's where I would have predicted it to have been. Okay, and then we know about seizures as well. Dr. Karen, the seizure expert, was talking about frontal lobe seizures, which would be expected given he's got a hole in his frontal lobe. We've talked about how that impairs decision-making, impairment in reading social cues, social judgment. Those things are all affected when you have damage in these areas. And then the traumatic effects on the brain, as I mentioned, not physical ones, the emotional ones, the neural connection forming, et cetera, the way in which the limbic system, that's our emotional center, is hyperactive. We tend to get over-emotional. We tend to get overexcited to things that we don't need to. Okay? So it gets worse and worse and worse when you have all those kinds of things together. And you're hearing a lot about things that Mr. Wiggins could do. He could get a GED. He could drive a car. He could have a job as a plumber, okay? That's all fine. Everybody here has strengths and has weaknesses, okay? In our field, when you're talking about mental health, when you're talking about medical illnesses, it's not important what you can do, it's what you can't do, okay? If you're depressed 13 out of 14 days and you come and tell me, hey, look, on that one day I was not depressed, I don't care. 13 out of 14 means you're depressed, okay? Because you're not functioning the way you ought to be functioning. Your mood is impaired more often than it's not, okay? So it is the deficits that define the disease. It is not the strengths. We're not interested in what he can do. People can do all kinds of things. People with brain damage can do a number of things, and again, as they say, make look normal. But under stress, under the right conditions, what is most likely to happen, right? And that's where the deficits show up. So as you're thinking about this and you're considering all this information, look at the deficits. Look at the problems that he's having, because that's really where the issues lie. That's how we make diagnoses. That's how we decide treatment plans. Think about any time you've ever seen a doctor in your lives. Did he or she treat what you could do or treat what you couldn't do, right? If you were having problems with concentration, if your blood pressure was too high, if those kinds of issues, right? The doctor's got to help you get back to where you are, right? Where you want to be, not how good you're doing. That's not the point then, right? We don't do anything.
Counsel, approach the bench, please.
Dr. Agharkar.
At the conclusion of all of the work that you did, everything that you reviewed, what was your summary, conclusions as it related to Mr. Wiggins?
Mr. Wiggins suffers from a neurocognitive disorder, brain damage. Okay. Likely he was born this way, and it's resulted in seizures, hallucinations, reduced ability to read social cues, irritability, impulsivity, and emotional dysregulation. Kind of in a nutshell, those are the ways in which his various brain areas have impacted him. While brain damage is not curable, symptoms like this are treatable. He is being treated with medications that he was not taking on the street because he couldn't afford it, as well as he's in a structured environment, and he's done very well. And so it's showing, in fact, that he can have a good response with medication and being in a structured environment. And so there is treatment available, there's good treatment available, and he's responding to it. And so I think that's how I would end it.
Thank you. Pass the witness.
Crouch, you may cross-examine. Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, anybody need a recess, a brief recess? All right, let's take about a 10-minute recess to allow everybody to have a restroom break and stretch our legs.
All right. As far as the recess.